It's great when movies leave you wanting so much more. But what about when they just leave a nagging question agonizingly unanswered? For some films, it can ensure that you're the first one in line to get the answer in the sequel. While in others, the question is actually destined to be left hanging forevermore, with audiences instead forced to ponder it amongst themselves. So, with that in mind, I'm Ellie with What Culture, here with 10 unanswered questions from recent movies. Number 10. Was Rocket's trip to the afterlife real in Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 3? At the end of Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 3's second act, the heroes obtain the code to override the kill switch implanted in Rocket, in turn saving his life. But before Rocket returns to the land of the living, he first flatlines and has what appears to be a vision of the afterlife, where he's greeted by his fellow experimented upon animals Lila, Tiefs, and Floor. However, Lila eventually tells Rocket that it's not yet his time to join them, just as Quill uses the code to bring him back to life. This sequence, moving though it isn't elaborated upon, with the audience left to decide for themselves whether Rocket genuinely witnessed the afterlife or this was simply a near-death experience generated by his brain. On one hand, we've never seen a typical afterlife slash heaven in the MCU, but given that we have seen similar locations like Valhalla, Soul World, and the Ancestral Plane, it's certainly easy to believe that Rocket's experience was indeed real. But on the other, Rocket's vision had hallmarks of a garden variety near-death experience, taking place in a brilliant white void, for instance. If James Gunn's smart, and he certainly is, he'll never answer this one and let fans make up their own minds. Number 9. Who killed Barry's mother in The Flash? Despite The Flash being centered around the murder of Barry Allen's mother, Nora, the film never actually reveals the identity of the person who fatally stabbed her in her own kitchen. You can argue that the killer isn't terribly important in the grand scheme of things, yet in both the comics and the CW-produced Flash TV series, Barry's mother was killed by supervillain Eobard Thorne, aka Reverse Flash, aka Professor Zoom. However, we get not even a hint of Reverse Flash's presence in this film, leaving the culprit of Nora's murder totally up in the air. That said, in post-release interviews, director Andy Muschietti did heavily imply that the movie followed in the footsteps of the comics and TV series, and indeed, Nora here was also killed by Reverse Flash. All the same, we never see it happen on screen, nor is it even remotely hinted at, which combined with a planned sequel clearly not happening means we're never going to get concrete confirmation. Number 8. Will the Core Four stay in New York City in Scream 6? Scream 6's big juicy hook is that it was the first film in the series to take place in New York City, lending it a distinctly different flavor compared to its California set predecessors. Set a year after the fifth Scream, the sequel sees the Core Four, Sam, Tara, Mindy, and Chad, living together in New York City, with all but Sam attending Blackmore University. But by film's end, with the Ghostfaces killed and the Core Four all still very much alive, it's left up in the air whether or not the quartet will remain in the Big Apple. On one hand, nobody could blame them for desiring a scenery change after the trauma they've experienced, but given that going back to Woodsboro probably wouldn't make much sense either, where would they go? More to the point, being a year into their studies, would they really want to up sticks and start over again elsewhere? With the development of Scream 7 currently delayed due to both Jenna Ortega's busy schedule and the ongoing WGA SAG strikes, we likely won't have the concrete answer for a little while. But while we're on the subject, where do you think would be a good setting for a Scream movie? Let us know in the comments down below. Number 7. How was Indy found innocent of murder in Indiana Jones and the Dial of Destiny? In the fifth and final Indiana Jones film, Indy becomes a wanted man, being framed for the murder of two of his colleagues at Hunter College at the hands of Jürgen Voller's goons. While the evidence against Indy is ultimately relatively flimsy, a bloody hand on a phone circumstantially placing him at the scene, the film more or less implies that it's ironclad, with the NYPD embarking on a manhunt to capture him. But this thread is basically abandoned once Indy sets off on his adventure, and by film's end, we never hear how the matter is resolved. While we're left to infer that Indy was somehow exonerated, how was he? After all, it's not like the authorities will believe the particulars of Indy's adventure, especially that he fought time-traveling Nazis, and given that the only witness to all of his acts is Helena Shaw, the cops are unlikely to give a criminal's testimony much weight. Evidently, James Mangold and co. likely realized they couldn't satisfactorily provide an explanation for this, and so they just didn't. Number 6. Were Janet and Kang romantically involved in Ant-Man and the Wasp: Quantumania? It says a lot that perhaps the biggest question coming away from the latest Ant-Man movie wasn't what the hell is going on with Kang, but rather, did Kang and Janet hook up or what? It's established early on that Janet Van Dyne and Kang spent a lot of time together while they were trapped in the Quantum Realm for years, and so fans naturally wondered whether or not the pair got amorous during that period. After all, they're both attractive people who were shown to have solid chemistry, and Janet makes it clear that she did have romantic liaisons during her 30 years in the Quantum Realm, flat out admitting that she had needs and got down with Lord Kryler. Shortly after Quantumania's release, writer Jeff Loveness was grilled by IGN about the prospect of Janet and Kang hooking up and said of the matter, "Oh, I mean, yeah, you got Mr. Hunk over there all day, so mysterious. He's got this little orb. I mean, I don't know what's in that orb, but I think there's a lot of strength in those types of relationships that could go either way. And maybe it did, maybe it didn't. Maybe that's a reason why she didn't want to tell her family about it. But yeah, maybe they had sex. Who knows?" So maybe it happened. Kang it slash Jang shippers, your hope remains alive. If you pardon the pun. Number 5. Is John really dead in John Wick Chapter 4? The fourth and possibly final mainline John Wick film ends with Keanu Reeves' titular assassin killing the Marquis Vincent Bissett de Gramont, granting him freedom from the High Table moments before he appears to die from wounds sustained during the final duel. Though we see John keel over motionless and later glimpse Winston and the Bowery King visiting his grave, many nevertheless felt that John's fate wasn't quite as definitive as it first appeared. While it would certainly be dramatically fitting for John to die, especially as he asks Winston to take him home and is shown remembering his late wife Helen in his apparently final moments, it's also undeniable that money talks. With Chapter 4 grossing more than any other film in the series by a margin of over $100 million, it goes without saying that there's still an audience appetite for more stories featuring this character. While a fifth film was recently confirmed by Lionsgate, in addition to next year's Ballerina prequel, which will feature Reeves in a supporting role, it remains to be seen whether or not John will be brought back from the dead. As ever, only time will tell. Number 4. How long has G.I. Joe known about the Transformers in Transformers: Rise of the Beasts? The latest Transformers movie ends with a hilariously unexpected crossover tease as protagonist Noah Diaz is recruited to join the G.I. Joe organization, teeing up a potential future Transformers G.I. Joe spin-off. Yet the shock reveal raises one tantalizing question. How long has the G.I. Joe outfit known about the existence of the Transformers? Were they aware of them prior to the events of this movie, or was this their first introduction to the robots in disguise? The scene comes and goes quickly without any wider context, such that fans are simply left to speculate on it. Even the creatives don't know yet, but if the spin-off ever does happen, which with Rise of the Beasts' soft box office is certainly no guarantee, we should find out. Number 3. Why were the family chosen in Knock at the Cabin? M. Night Shyamalan's new psychological horror, Knock at the Cabin, revolves around a family who are terrorized by four strangers asking them to sacrifice one of their own in order to prevent an impending apocalypse. Beyond the central mystery of are the strangers telling the truth, we're also left to ponder why this family unit was chosen, and it remains ambiguous all the way to the film's bittersweet conclusion. That isn't to say there aren't suggestions. One of the quartet, Leonard, believes the family was selected because their love for each other was so pure, while noting the bigotry Eric and Andrew had experienced as gay men adopting a young girl, Wen. It's certainly possible to take Leonard's claim at face value, especially given that Eric comes to agree with this by film's end and ultimately sacrifices himself, but at the same time, it's never really elaborated on or committed to in any fashion. Number 2. How is Giselle still alive in Fast X? Fast X's absurd final scene sees Letty and Cypher be rescued from Antarctica by a most unexpected face, Giselle Yashar, who was last seen apparently dying on the world's longest runway back in Fast and Furious 6. Indeed, Giselle shows up in a submarine to save the day, yet the scene abruptly ends before any further explanation of her inexplicable survival is given. After all, Giselle was shown falling from a fast-moving plane to the ground in the sixth film, and yet has reappeared here without so much as a facial scar to show for it. How then is she still alive, given that her death didn't seem in any way ambiguous? Considering the filmmakers didn't exactly provide audiences with a satisfactory explanation for Hans's unlikely resurrection either, it's probably reasonable to anticipate the very same here. A vague hand wave and the expectation that fans will just accept that death means nothing in this franchise anymore. Number 1. Why did Elaine die in Beau is Afraid? One of the many shocking scenes in Ari Aster's surreal horror film Beau is Afraid involves the death of Beau's decades-long crush, Elaine. It's established early on in the film that Beau is pathologically afraid of sex due to his father apparently dying of a heart murmur during his conception. And so, when he reconnects with Elaine in the present day and they have sex, Beau is relieved that he survives the tryst. But in an ironic twist, it's Elaine who dies while climaxing, her body eerily frozen stiff. Like much of what happens in the film, this is never given a concrete explanation, with audiences instead invited to figure it out for themselves. Perhaps the most basic rationale is that Beau managed to redirect his deathly climax into Elaine instead, but it might be best not to examine Astor's film too literally, accepting the generally dreamlike, nightmarish even, logic upon which it operates. And that concludes our list. If you think we missed something, then please do let us know in the comments down below. And while you're there, don't forget to like and subscribe and tap that notification bell. Also, head over to Twitter and follow us there. And I can be found across various social medias just by searching Ellie Littlechild. I've been Ellie with What Culture. I hope you have a magical day and I'll see you real soon.